when I went there, I didn't know that I'm going to such a place where there's no light, no gas, no water.
Salamu, 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 salamu alaikum ya jamaa, salamu alaikum ya jamaa, assalamu alaikum.
We bore witness to love. Love that transcends color and borders from the blessed people of Ghana for Hazrat Khalifatul Masih. They returned the love and care this humbled servant gave to them for 8 years, until the entire nation reached out to him and embraced him as her own.
When I was here, I did not think of abandoning this country. I considered myself to be a Ghanaian.
Join us on this unforgettable journey in this two-part series as we tread the footsteps of humility and humanity exemplified by Hazur as a young devotee.
A very unassuming, gentle and a humble human being.
Witness the example of dedication.
That man was good. He, if not because of him, like this school would not come to stay.
Witness the example of love.
That's my best friend.
He was teaching you English.
Witness the example of brotherhood.
President today, Huzu, could lay his head with us.
It's an example of humility. It's an example of obedience. It's an example of commitment. It's an example of recognizing a human being for his worth.
Salamu alaikum ya jama. Assalamu alaikum.
This was the moment dreamt by the thousands, and yet not witnessed until 1970, when Hazrat Khalifatul Masih III graced Ghana with his presence. Little did anyone know what blessed doors this visit would open in the future. Love for all and hatred for none is what Hazur had preached, and on his return from Ghana, he put it into practice like never before by launching the Nusrat Jahan scheme. Under the scheme, schools and hospitals were started around Ghana and then eventually all over Africa.
When I decided to sacrifice my life for work for Zindagi, Tariq-e-Deed office was, I think, they didn't need me because they thought that we don't want somebody who is qualified in this particular subject. I wrote directly to Khalifatul Masih Salis, and he marked that letter to Tariq-e-Deed. So Tariq-e-Deed replied back to Khalifatul Masih Salis that we don't need this boy at present. As soon as Khalifatul Masih Salis received this letter, he said, "You don't need him, but I need him." Then he asked me to go to through Nusrat Jahan to Africa, Ghana. He embraced me, and that was the first ever experience I had by embracing any of the Khalifas. So anyway, then I went to Ghana. The very important thing he asked me, that remember that you are going to Ghana as Waqf-e-Zindagi teacher. And also remember that you belong to the family of Prophet Musa al-Islam. And people there will always keep their eyes on you. So always remember Allah and don't do any act which is against the teachings of Islam and Ahmadiyyat.
Sahibzada Hazrat Mirza Masroor Ahmad dedicated his life and through the scheme was posted to a very remote and unknown part of northern Ghana as headmaster for the secondary school Jamaat had started in the small town of Salaga. So straight from the comforts of Pakistan to the harshness of the barren north, where Hazur spent an entire year by himself, humbly carrying out his duties.
The principal of the school took me along with him from Kumasi to that place, Salaga. It's the remotest town in northern region of Ghana. The house was very small, two rooms, just for 3-4 feet. On one side there was a kitchen, then toilet, bath. I stayed alone for almost 1 year without my family. First I learnt making chapatis there from our missionaries who was living in Tamale. Early morning for the breakfast, and normally I used to take bread and egg and so on. No afternoon lunch, like an evening after closing from the school, around 4 o'clock I'll prepare my food, sardine or yam, or prepare some chapatis. I lost almost 25 pounds of my weight at that time. And later on it was okay. So I enjoyed that adventure also. That was an adventure.
Now, 30 years later, we commence our journey from the same place where Hazur began his service as a devotee in Ghana.
So I'm now here at the TI Ahmadiyya Secondary School here in Salaga. And first of all, it was this place, this secondary school, that Hazur was first posted to when he arrived from Pakistan to Ghana. And I'm just going to go in there and ask a few people I can find there what they can tell me about Hazur's humble beginnings from here in Salaga.
Treading the same footsteps, it's hard to realize what this place was like when Hazur first arrived here. The Talimul Islam Ahmadiyya Secondary School in Salaga is one of the most recognized schools in the area today, with well over 1,000 students attending from all over the region. It is an incredibly huge establishment with all learning resources readily available for a range of students from different backgrounds and religions. But 30 years earlier, such a teaching facility was impossible to imagine in this region, as secular education was an absolute no for any child. Today, it's a very different story, as you can see.
I can't believe what I'm seeing. How many do we have here? 1, 2, 3,000 plus, 2,000? Well, I don't know, you tell me for yourself. So many of them here, and 30 years ago, when Hazur was here, it was almost an impossibility trying to convince parents to send their children to school. 30 years on, look at the numbers of students here. Woo.
Salaga was hundreds of miles away from the rapidly progressing winds of Accra. If this region of Ghana was to progress, then the people had to embrace secular education. Jamaat had built a small school, but the real challenge was getting the students.
At the time Hazur came here, secular education was considered a taboo, a grievous sin. When the Jamaat established the school, the classrooms were pretty much empty.
If you talk of Salaga in those days, Salaga was a place where first people were not interested in education. And so if they are not interested in education, they are not going to promote education. So somebody going there is not going to be encouraged. It is as simple as that.
Now, to talk of Salaga TI Ahmadiyya Senior High School, you're talking of a secondary school in the most deprived area of Ghana, where there are no facilities whatsoever for any living. Water is a problem, electricity is a problem, where even to lay your head is a problem. But he endured.
Wonderful thing about him is he never complained. Never, ever, for all the 8 years that he lived here, did we see anything of the kind. But I can tell you that it was not easy to live in Salaga.
It was during this time the Jamaat, with the efforts of the then chief of the area, the Kimbewura, had to go around to convince people to send their children to school for secular education. It was during this time that Huzu came into the picture, and it took a lot of resolve, dedication, and resilience from Huzu to be able to add to the numbers of children who came to school. He had to help in building the amenities, the infrastructure, and provide accommodation for some of the students. And almost all of them had free education and their meals heavily subsidized for them.
Mr. Dimbye is the current headmaster of the school, and he can give us an insight into the role Huzu played in the development of this school.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. I'm all right.
I'm also fine. And how's the school?
Very fine.
Alhamdulillah. We would like to take a look around.
We can go.
Mr. Dimbye takes us to the original block, which was refurbished by Huzu. At the time, this was the only building.
This is Old Amas, the first structure built on this site in 1976 that has four classrooms.
So current Huzu may have taught in this structure because he was here when?
1977. And so definitely as a headmaster, he did not only do administrative work, he also did some teaching in the classrooms.
Oh, so headmasters at the time were not only doing administration work, they were also fully participating in teaching.
They
so it's very possible that our current Huzu may have taught in one of these classrooms here.
Yes, just that, exactly. So you see the students there and the classrooms.
Yes.
So possibly
he would have taught here.
Yes.
So can we go inside the classroom and just replay in our own minds what the situation used to be like?
Yes.
Assalamu alaikum, everyone. How you all doing? Oh, so we now have a full classroom. This is about how many students?
That's about 60 plus students.
60 plus students.
Yes.
But 30 years ago, it was very difficult to even have up to 15 students in a class like this.
The whole school population was 15.
The whole school?
The whole school population was 15.
Amazing.
And look at the number of girls in this classroom alone. Mm. But you had only three girls in 1971.
Wow. The whole school
population? The whole school
population
was 15. 12 boys and 3 girls.
Wow. All the struggle they had to go through, the founding fathers of this school, including Huzu.
Yes.
What has it achieved? Has it impacted on the society, the community around?
It's beneficial. Mm. It's terribly rewarding that you look at the population, the accessibility of it. The district director of education acknowledged that this school is one of the schools that admits the chunk of the junior high school graduates in the whole district.
Tell me about it.
Students and parents come to beg for admissions. And at times we switch off our mobile phones. At times we run away. At times we put on the notice, admissions closed.
And
people still come to seek admission. From a very humble beginning and difficulties, a lot of sacrifices put in the school, it has paid off. We have a current student population of 1,200, made up of all shades of students. Talking about religions and all around the country make up this population. The infrastructural status of the school is quite commendable. We have 25 classrooms, 2 giant dormitories for boys and girls, and there are still some being constructed. Then we also have a library facility, we have a science lab, we have other facilities in the school. Then if you want to look at generally the programs that we run in the school, The school started with two programs, business and general arts. Today, we have 5 programs, business, general arts, science, agri, and home economics. These are the 5 programs run in the school, and highly competitive.
Since its humble beginnings, TI Salaga has made rapid progress through the years, and in its course, it has shaped the lives of people throughout the entire region.
And so 30 years on after the establishment of this school, I can't imagine that this school has come this far. This is the cadet corps of the school and doing a march past some of the dignitaries on the days there. And some of those people you see on the days there actually include very high level government officials. Some of them are high level district chief executives and all that. And some of them did attend this school. And this is how far this school has come. And one can only imagine the kind of sacrifice that had to go into establishing this school.
The original school at the time of Hazu's arrival was a disused, abandoned building, and Hazu literally had to rebuild the school from the ground up. Salaga is 90 miles away from the nearest city of Tamale, where all the supplies for the school had to be bought from.
If he needs anything, he cannot get from the market because it's a small place. So he has to travel to a place like Tamale or to go to Kumasi.
Those days, one, you wouldn't even have that luxury of thinking about how many hours are you going to take.
Yeah.
That's one. Mm. Two, which means of the transport was going to carry you? Mm. Is it a tractor or that? The mummy trucks, there was one Tata bus that served from Tamale to Makango. Mm. But even the third day, I was very tiny. I had to struggle between people before I could get to the gate.
Why 3 days? Did you have a breakdown?
No, that was the only means for so many people.
Yes, so?
The struggle and the competition was high.
This was in
83? 83.
And Huzuru was here in 77
and 79.
And so by 83, things may have even improved a bit.
Better.
Oh.
Huzuru would travel on public transport available at the time himself 90 miles on dusty broken roads to Tamale and bring building materials 90 miles back. And public transport in northern Ghana at that time wasn't exactly what you may have in mind.
This is the kind of road that Huzu would travel on anytime he needed to travel between Salaga and Tamale, whenever he needed any small thing for his family or for himself. And when he was lucky, he would do this journey on a bus. Otherwise, he had no other choice but to make the journey 90 miles away from here on, well, the notorious mode of transportation known in Ghana as
bone shaker. It's a sort of truck made of wood, you know, timber. It's not the type of, metallic, vehicles that we know of. So they call it bone shaker because even the seat is made up of just timber of that, width. We put it there and then we sit on it.
Sometimes you take about 2 days to recover from the kind of pain you receive after riding in a vehicle like this. Usually it's made of wooden structures and with big ties, sometimes double ties behind it. And usually it's a rickety vehicle, as you can see, not much can be said. But during the time Huzu was here, these are the kinds of vehicles he used to travel on whenever he didn't have the government vehicle that would usually take him from Makango to Tamale through Salaga and all that. So these are the kind of vehicles he used to ride on. Now, what you actually see here is a modern type of bone shaker. We couldn't lay hands on the type that Huzu himself used to ride on, but we're fortunate to have a replica from the T.I. Ahmadiyya Secondary School in Salaga. I'll now jump on the bone shaker track and have a ride and just have a feel of what Huzu may have been going through whenever he took a ride on a bone shaker.
Tamale, 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 Tamale. Sorry. This is a real life experience about what Huzoo actually.
This is my first experience, man. Thanks, man.
This is only the beginning for Abdul Hai, but he is about to find out what bone shaker really means.
So I am riding in a modern day bone shaker. This is not the exact type you would find 30 years ago. Can you tell me your experiences in riding in bone shakers?
Actually, riding in bone shaker is a hell. If you look at it, at the end of the day, when you get to your destination, you can't best tell whether it's your joints, your waist, your pain, your eyes. You can't even tell exactly which part of your body that is disturbing you.
Yeah, what are some of the challenges in riding on a bone shaker? Have you ever been in an accident or something?
Oh, for the bone shaker, accident in bone shaker, most of times a lot of people die, just like fowls. Because when the vehicle is landing, there's nothing to protect you.
And how often do bone shakers break down in terms of the engine, maybe brake failures and all?
Particularly this part of the country, most of our bone shakers don't even have brakes. So they use the GS to control.
Say that again. They don't have what?
They don't have brakes.
So how do they stop?
So when he's going, the driver use the GS. Uh-huh. If he's accelerating so much, you push it to the first. In other so that you see that the vehicle will be shaking, ejecting here and there. Then sometimes the driver mate will jump down, push the track, a chalk, then the vehicle will run over it and will pick it and push it for the second time before the vehicle is able to slow down.
I can't believe it.
With his man.
This man can do the job. Look at him there.
So in a situation where the driver has to make an emergency stop, what happens?
That is why we have a lot of accidents in the system, because it cannot stop when in terms of emergency stop.
So what this means and what it tells me is that Huzoo was so humble that anytime he could not get a ride on a government bus, he would join one of these trucks. And I just told you that this truck is more comfortable than what was used 30 years ago.
This is what we meant when we said the public transport which Huzoo used to take for 90 miles and back.
Oh, what a ride, man. What a ride. I can't believe this.
One of the lovely rides in town.
To me, the dust was too much.
I know. When I even ride in this bone shaker, I could assume the real bone shaker Huzoo used how he feel.
From Salaga, there was a big city called Tomale. We used to go there for building material, because at that time we were building some school block, even for your commodities like groceries and all things, sort of things. There was no proper means of transport. There was only one government transport bus. We used to come from Tomale in the morning time and one in the evening time. Nobody knows at what time it will get broken down and you are stranded on the way. Once I and our missionary, Razak Bhatsab, were traveling to Tomale. You would not find any place even to stand there. So what we used to do is take the bus when it reaches to Salaga and go to the end of the road, 17 miles further, and there you could easily get some seat. So we used to do 34 miles extra travel for getting a seat. One day, bus got broken down there. It was evening time. I was going to purchase some building material for our building. We were contractor there, we were builder there, we were everybody. I was everything there. I was having some big amounts in my briefcase. Night was fast approaching, and I was afraid that, as for me, it doesn't matter, but this money, somebody can snatch the bag and then take it away. Anyway, 8, 9, 10, so later on they announced that now they have sent the message to Tomale, the bus will soon come. And that soon was after 8 hours. So we spent the whole night there. I found some bench there. I sat on it and held my briefcase very, very firmly. And I asked Maulvi Sahib that I think half night you sleep and half night I sleep. The next morning, around 4 o'clock in the morning, the bus came and we climbed on it and reached Tumale. And that was also a good adventure.
Islam has been brought by Allah. Let them merge it. It is the way to Allah.
Well, so far I've felt it, I've seen it all, and I've heard it all from people who lived with Huzuru whilst he stayed in Salaga. Now, these people tell me that while Huzuru lived with them, he exhibited so much resilience, resolve, commitment, and the fear of God to the extent that it reflected in whatever he did. I'm now on my way to Esacho, where Huzuru was posted to after 3 years of service in Salaga, to speak to a few people about the life he led whilst he stayed here.
After 3 years of service in Salaga, Huzuru was posted to another small and unknown town of Esacho. Esacho lies at a distance of just over a mile from another small town, Ikrafu, which holds immense importance for Jamaat, as this was the birthplace of Ahmadiyyat in Ghana. Esacho was no Salaga. Even today, it is an incredibly small town. And even if the harsh savanna of the north was switched with a more greener area, Esacho did not come without its challenges for Huzuru. Even here, getting students to come to school was no easy task. But it was the wise Ikumfi Paramount Chief Nana Achin who gave his complete support for the school and welcomed the Jamaat to run it. We're here to meet the chief's son, Augustus Achin, who can throw more light on Huzuru's time in Esacho.
I'm fine, how are you too?
I'm very fine.
That's good.
Can you tell me about Nana Achin, your father, who used to be chief here?
Nana Achin, he was the chief of Ikumfi, traditional area, and he ruled for almost 40 years. And even one time he was the presidential commissioner during the Nkrumah regime.
Wow.
When Nkrumah is not there, he used to replace Nkrumah. Those days.
Nkrumah, the first president.
The first president of Ghana.
Uh-huh. So this is where he used to live.
This way, where?
I've heard there was a man
who
came from Pakistan, did some work in the northern region, and then was posted to this very town.
Okay, yes.
And your father, what did your father do for
you? Yes, the same thing. My father also gave his complete...
Do you remember this man?
I remember that man.
What was his name?
He was Ahmed.
Mr. Ahmed.
Something Ahmed.
That's what you remember, Mr.
Yes,
Ahmed.
Yes.
Okay.
He was the headmaster of the Ahmadiyya Secondary School.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, so he came, I think, when he came, my father welcomed him very well.
Mm.
And he gave out his burden, complete burden to him, on free of charge.
Oh.
Because my father wants the school to come and stay.
I see that building?
Yes, you can see.
The very first place.
Exactly,
your
very
dad gave
first
to him.
Place my dad gave to him.
So, this is the building?
Yes. This is the building.
Wow.
This is where my father gave it to the first headmaster of the Ahmadiyya.
Do you remember the first day he moved in?
Yes, they brought him from Accra.
Mm.
So he, that time my father have already assured the Amil in Ghana that whoever comes as the headmaster, he is prepared to give out his burden to him. So the burden was just there standby for any who comes in.
So your dad was ready to release his building to accommodate the headmaster of the Ahmadiyya Secondary School, Ahmadiyya School
exactly,
here in Esacho.
Exactly. Not even the accommodation of the headmaster alone. He also give out other buildings also for schools and then dormitories as well. And the schools are also here, which I think we can...
Oh, just here?
Yes, just here. Before then, it was a market.
Mm.
But because my father want the school to come and stay.
Yeah.
He bought these brick blocks and then fence wall it.
Mm-hmm.
For the meantime, the students should be here.
Mm.
So that's the form one, form two, form three. In those days, people doesn't want to patronize, people doesn't want to attend schools. So my father made it compulsory that each and every person in this community should try and bring one of his child to the school. So my father set an example by sending his two daughters.
Oh, daughters?
Yes.
Wow.
Doctors. He set that example so that he can hold people to that. Here, eventually, it was a market. This place was a market.
Yeah.
But because there was no option, so my father sat down and then he said no. Compulsively, because if he made a big, a least mistake, the school will not come to stay.
Yeah.
So he converted this market into the school. He made this place a school by force. The headmaster, yes. He was a very good friend to my father.
Really?
So, yes, that Ahmed. But he was so nice, and he was very committed to the school. He liked the school. And every day he wanted things to be put in order. He was good. That man was good. He, if not because of him, like this school would not come to stay.
Yes. So now the school is at Ekurafo, between Ekurafo and Esache.
So with time, my father sat down. My father found out that no, the place was growing. Yeah. The school was growing.
Oh.
Do I look a big place for them as a land for them to build a big school? So he started the move.
So he moved himself.
He moved and then he went to in between Ekurafo and Esache. And we had a very big land there. That time I was a young guy and I was following my father.
I think
he was
to,
in the bush himself.
So we have to go to that school.
Yes, we have to go to that.
The original school, which used to be here, had to
move completely to the place.
Because it had the numbers exceeded what this building
exactly
could contain. Whoa.
Exactly.
Whoa, great.
Chief Nana Achin was so committed to bringing education to his people that he put up one of his personal houses as accommodation for Hazu and the students.
Yes, this is the building. This is where Mr. Ahmed was staying. This is where my father gave.
This is where our president Hazu used to live.
Yes.
Where exactly? It's a very big house.
Yes,
was the whole house?
The whole house belonged to him? No, he was occupying the top.
Oh, okay.
And then some of the students were down.
Woo! So he shared a building with students.
Exactly.
Did he ever complain? Did he ever feel diminished?
He never.
Never?
The man. No, that's why I was saying that the man was so good to extend that he also was committed. And he liked the job they've given to him. And he performed the job marvelously.
Wow.
So that's the main entrance. The whole place was for him, was given out to him.
You mean the top?
He was staying at the top, so we will go there.
Okay.
We will go to the top.
Yes. So let's go then.
Let's go then.
So, it's quite. Have a look. It's quite a narrow staircase.
That's the kitchen.
Okay. Wonderful. And has anything changed?
That's the kitchen. Nothing.
But do you remember some of the food stuff? For instance, you know, they have chapati.
When I come, he gives me tea and egg. A cooked egg.
So the egg was fried here, right here in this.
He doesn't normally fry his egg. He cook it. Cooked one.
Yeah.
Wow. He doesn't fry it. So let me take you to where I've been taking when I come. those days I was very young. Ganaman.
He's a typical Ganaman. He loves his banku. And Huzu made him love tea and egg. Woo! Oh, it's a big hall.
Yes.
It's a very big hall.
Yes, that's the hall.
Yes.
Yes, that's the hall.
Okay.
When I come to him, he let me sit down here. The wife of the person.
There was a dining table here?
Yes, a dining table here.
And then there was a
and then
similar
CCA.
Okay. This man who came all the way from Pakistan and will come down to the level of the local people, would not complain about facilities that were lacking.
Yeah.
You as a child and your father's own opinion, what would you say about him?
Oh, the man is the type of person which I think if you give him any position or any, he's very responsible. Mm. The man is very, that's why I'm saying that I'm not doubting where he has reached now.
Okay.
He speaks his mind. Mm. The man always speaks his mind. He doesn't have anything within him. That's how I see him.
So the day he announced that he was leaving this house,
yeah,
what was the mood in the house?
Actually, my father didn't like it. But it's like something like a contract. The contract has expired. Mm-hmm. Therefore, he has to go back to Pakistan. Mm-hmm. So we have no option. Mm-hmm. It is only the Amir those days who can say, okay, I'll renew the contract for you to stay back. Mm-hmm. But I think for that those days, then he was also feeling that at least he has done enough. Mm-hmm. And the school has gotten a foundation. Therefore, he can leave to Pakistan. So normally that's where, if my father,
yeah,
my father, he stays at that building where I show you.
Yeah.
So if he is coming with his car, he will just park here, and then he will say, call me the white man. So they will call him, and then he will come here,
yeah,
and then maybe relax here. Then my father will be talking to him, whatever concerning the school.
Mm.
He is very neat, cleanliness, and discipline.
Mm.
Yes, that's what I could remember from him. But discipline and then cleanliness, it was part of. He was having one child.
That's what you can remember?
Yes, that's what I can
remember. Did he ever play with a child?
They play. Always he was handling the child.
Uh-huh.
Always. I can't remember very well. Yeah. A baby boy.
Mm.
Yeah.
Mm.
Always he was with him. Nice. Always.
Now that baby boy is a big man.
Well, I don't know.
He's like you.
Yeah. I see.
Tell me about water supply.
The water supply was a very big problem. You have to go to the riverside to take some water. In terms of bathing, and even those days, there was no this pure water.
Now it may seem a little more comfortable compared to Salaga, but living here again was not very simple. The water supply was very erratic, which meant water for Hazu's use had to be obtained from a nearby stream most of the times.
So at the time Hazu lived here in Nesachu, water supply was very erratic. It was very, very inconsistent. I am here with Mr. Abdurrahman Ensil here at the river, and he used to help Hazu when he stayed here at Nesachu. What used to happen? Can you describe to me what used to happen here?
Well, Nesachu, we have pipe-borne water as such. So usually, I do send water home for his activities over there. He's a man of himself. He loves everybody.
This is not your ideal running water, the ideal kind of water you'd want to use even for flushing your toilet, because it's not as clean as pipe-borne water would be, or as clean as even the water we use in our toilets these days. But this is the sort of water Hazu would use for other activities in his home when he lived here in Nesachu. Hold on. Whoa, it's heavy, man. I can't have it. Okay. Hang on. Okay. I think I'm
okay. It's okay.
It's okay now.
Okay.
Woo! Woo! No, I can't. No, I can't.
Let me help you.
Okay.
Let me. Then take the smaller one.
Okay. This is almost like it's as heavy as a 50 kilogram cement bag. As, yes. This,
of course.
Yes. And,
but this road is not fine. So let's take this route. Be careful unless you fall down.
Yeah,
if I fall.
No problem. You're a strong man.
But if you fall, there will be a problem.
So.
With the blessings of Allah and the continued efforts of Hazu and Chief Nana Achin, the school at Asarchir grew so much that Chief Nana Achin decided to donate 60 acres of his land at Ikrafu to construct a much larger school, which was to accommodate hundreds of students. This school was built by Hazu from the ground up, and the change in location meant that Jamaat decided there should be permanent residence for the headmaster on site. We're going to the headmaster's bungalow on site at T.I. Akumfi Senior High School to meet a very old acquaintance of Hazu.
Good morning.
Good morning, sir.
My name is Abdul Hai Mumen. What's your name? Your full name?
George Ankuma.
George Ankuma?
Yeah.
You used to work in this house?
Yes.
Who were you working for when you used to work in this house?
The headmaster, Mr. Mazu. No. 1982-83. I had a beer on your hoa on your beer.
So this is where Huzu used to stay and live, and this was his bedroom, in a nutshell.
Na me pepa ha, asana jumejibi wo baby amasana mako. Aso juala pa me ba me pepa ha, na kunsu na dini na. Na my head table na the bia offer to me in the bia my
So what do you remember about this man, Huzu Mirza Masroor Ahmed?
Me kai pa Mazu headmaster. A bibia obesia bia o ka che de o di kan ye brana ye bon ye nin kan ye mfa nyame mfa enye ye bibia so ne se kwetu ni yakopon a obran onko kan na otu ya pusu ye nya abotar ado far abotar se wa abotar wo adwuma ma betum da abo ubra pa ndi onam da mu efutu no de man mitumi idiru ma okwari na chirin ninya mfaso oduma metume tena dwuma mu ha kopimra medical pension oye adoye utum oho chirwa e kacho na otume bo awu ska afem.
So what was his relationship with you as a person like? Because obviously he was the master, he was the headmaster of the school, and you were just a mere servant. Did he ever make you feel like you were just a mere servant?
You naturally me tie nenshi she biara oduma mam biara. And the to kwan kra o to me me ko be 3 days kra wo mission a crampa o to me me ko sende o jimi di na me so mi jini di na ne mo fra be no o wo e mo fra mi no ne ba o cast na fella
okay
am no na mo fra mi no na mi wo nyina e wo ha and no wo nyina wo pemase.
The blessings of the divinely inspired Nusrat Jahan scheme on Ghana have been far-reaching and wide. Through the prayers and constant guidance of Khilafat, the people of Ghana have been on the receiving end of high-quality education, especially in the remotest parts of the country, where the future leaders of tomorrow are being groomed by the dedicated teachers and devotees such as Hazur. And we really did not have to look far for evidence. Miss Forstein is an ex-student of Hazur and is currently the assistant headmistress for one of the biggest schools in the region.
How are you doing?
Fine, thank you.
You were an old school student here. How long ago was this?
I was here in 1983 on this very compound.
But the school did not start from this compound?
No, the school started from Isachiri, the market center there.
Were you there as well?
Yes.
And that was in
1980.
So at the time that you were a student on the other campus,
yes,
and then moving here, can you remember some of the headmasters along the way?
Yes, I quite remember Mazu Masu. Yes, he was the headmaster who brought us here.
Okay.
So initially, he allowed us to be coming here to plant the trees, you see, alongside the road and the campus.
Oh, can you point to one of the trees if you can remember? This some, yes.
This one, beginning from the gate, all trees,
Wow.
And he was involved.
Mm-hmm.
So the trees on the campus, he was part of the school that we planted.
Wow.
Yes, to give shade to the school because the school was bare.
Mm-hmm.
And he did that before he moved us to the school here.
So when you moved here, what was the infrastructure like? Well, did we have all these buildings here?
No, we moved here with this block.
So when you moved here, we didn't have all these buildings.
No, no, no.
Just this block. Tell me more.
There were five classrooms, so we shared five classrooms.
Mm.
And that room was his Mizra unit office.
Oh, the first one there.
First one.
Wow, I'd like to have a look.
All the rest were classrooms for us.
Yeah.
And I came to Form 3 here.
Mm-hmm. So this is one of the very early classrooms.
Room.
Good morning.
Good morning.
How are you all doing?
Same classroom. It's only the whiteboard that has been changed.
Yes.
Yes. It was a blackboard.
Mm. So what do you remember about some of your teachers whenever they came to the classroom? What would they usually do? Do you remember those days, 30 years back?
Yes, 30 years back. I remember some of them. A teacher we used to call Ms. Ye, who teaches French.
Mm.
Yes. He was short and he easily got annoyed. So the least thing, he would get annoyed and walk out from the classroom. But at a point in time, he will come and settle us down and we'll continue.
All right.
Yes.
Mm. So at the time, Mirza Masroor Ahmed was your headmaster.
Mm-hmm.
What kind of headmaster was he? Was he the strict type, the one who would insist that the things be done the right way? Was he the soft type, one who would just allow you to do anything you wanted to do at all?
Israel was calm, but strict and firm. Would wish things had done well.
Mm.
Yes. So I quite remember
mm-hmm.
he was meeting us here. That is where we're having our Sunday morning.
Where is that? Yeah, out here?
Out here.
Oh, wow. This is where you used to meet during your morning assemblies and all that. Do you remember him saying anything, addressing the assembly in any way? Here.
If we want to complete school, then we should know how to behave well. And becoming recalcitrant will not help us.
Mm.
And he knows he is here to help us to learn and grow up well for the society.
Okay.
Yes. So we should listen to whatever they tell us here. Not to break school rules, and not to do things that put the name of the school into disrepute.
So now you are assistant headmistress in one of the biggest senior secondary schools in Ghana. How would you say this school and the moral lessons taught, especially by Mirza Masroor Ahmed, how would you say that has influenced your life?
It has influenced my life greatly because I took some of the things he said as I'm talking about. And he made me to develop interest in the Islamic religious knowledge. And I offered that and had one. And that Islamic religious knowledge, I had one, took me to training college at Ola. What I would tell him was when I was on the field, he put me in a track to run. I don't run. He said I should run.
You mean
and
sports?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
And he followed me with a cane. First, he finish her. So he made me to end my race.
Okay.
Yes. I can't remember this.
Yeah.
So this one, if I tell him,
he'll remember.
We're off to meet another person who had the privilege of serving Hazul while he was headmaster here.
Mr. Adam Saka.
Yeah.
How are you doing?
I'm
also very fine. When this school was first established, I mean this very campus, who was the headmaster?
Okay, the school started at Mr. Chiru.
Yes.
On 1971.
Yeah, I mean when you moved here to this campus, do you remember who the headmaster was?
It was the Hazul.
It was Huzur, Mirza Masroor Ahmed.
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah.
And you were working here at the time?
Yeah.
In what capacity?
I was the messenger.
You were the messenger?
Yeah, yeah.
And he was the headmaster?
Yeah, yeah.
So being the headmaster, obviously he had an office. Where was it?
Oh, this place.
Oh, this?
Yeah.
Oh!
Yeah, you can see from here.
So, all right. So, has anything changed here?
Oh, yes, a big change. There's a cupboard here.
Oh, so this was the office, just the small room?
Actually, this was the office.
Oh! Wow, this looks more like a storeroom in somebody's kitchen.
But this used to be the office. And being the messenger, did you ever hear him complain about being this place being a small office and that he couldn't operate from here? So first of all, start by telling me what your duties were.
Being a messenger, I have to go to him, correct the key, open the name, clean everything here, and arrange the papers, everything before he comes.
Okay.
So in case he needs you to send a letter to some place or anything, in case he needs something from the house, just give you a note, go to the house and give it to the wife, and then he also give you, in case he needed it, also have.
At the time there were no telephones. He didn't have mobile phones, so he couldn't ring the house, so he had to
give you a note.
And so whenever he called you in to give instructions, where would you be? Would you be standing here?
Oh, yeah. And then put my back.
Okay, so Adam Saka.
Oh, yeah.
So you as a messenger at the time, how did he relate to you? Was he commandeering? Was he always authoritative?
No, very kind to me. He was so kind to me.
Tell us more. Tell me more about the relationship.
If you need something, you come to him. Be open and then go to him. You explain things to him. If it is money, if anything else, you go to him. He will listen to you and then he will help you. Whatever you need, he will give it to you.
Tell us about the beginning of the school and the developments that you are now talking about.
The beginning of the school, you see, as I said earlier, they were forced to give scholarship. Because there were few people at this community. So the chief, that was the man of the community traditional area, called all the country, the town people, as well the chiefs. I need 3 people from your town so that they all sent to the same school so that the school will be filled up. This is what they started at.
And today was the situation.
Exactly. And this time, there was a lot of people from outside, even some from Accra, from the northern, the whole way.
It's plain to see that nearly everyone who interacted with Hazur at any level was left with a deep impression of his humility and humanity. The school itself is a living example of the tender love and care of Hazur. From a humble office and one block, today TI Ikumfi Senior High School is a massive facility catering for the educational and essential needs of well over 1,000 young minds. The man responsible for it today is the current headmaster of the school.
Assalamu alaikum, sir.
Wa alaikum salam.
Yeah, my name is Abdul Hai Mumin. Who are you, sir?
I'm the headmaster of the school, Mr. Muhammad Akunu.
So when you moved to this premises at that time, over 30 years ago, the population was just a little over 100.
Over 100.
What is the population today? As
today stands? Is 1,346.
Oh, that's a huge number.
Yes.
And you contain all of them on this campus?
On this campus. In fact, we have almost 300-400 being day students who come from town. The remaining around about 900 are on campus.
1,346, you said?
Yes.
That's a huge number.
Yes,
are students crowded in classrooms?
Not so much.
Hello, good morning, how are you? Okay.
Not so much.
All right. So every student has a desk to himself?
Yes. At least in the school, every student has a desk to himself.
So teaching and learning is relatively comfortable in this school.
Wow.
Can you tell us some of the courses you run in this school?
Basically, we run the general art course. We have a general science course. We have a business course. We have a technical course. And we have a vocational course.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
Ekunfi Amas.
God fearing and honesty.
Excellent Amas.
Discipline and hard work.
E Amas.
Lovely school of Caliphate.
Thank you.
That's wonderful. Ekunfi Amas. Alright, so did you attend the school yourself?
No.
Oh, you didn't?
No.
Oh, wow.
I'm a pro of Kumasi.
Okay, but then I'm sure this school has produced some excellent people for the outer world out there.
Yes.
Can we name a few of these people?
One whose name comes to mind easily is the Honorable A.T. Hammond, who was a pastor of the school.
Yes.
Currently, in fact, formerly he was the Deputy Internal Interior Minister. Then later on became the energy minister.
The deputy energy minister.
The deputy energy minister of the country. Mm. We have Bashuddin Hayford, who is a very good coach in the country, who is now managing Medeama Football Club. Yeah. And we have one Mr. Abakan, who was a lecturer at the University of Cape Coast.
Whoa. I'm sure if I gave you the whole day, you'll keep going on, because you've just mentioned a top government official produced from this school, very top-level government official, a top-level national coach, a Ghanaian coach.
Yes.
A footballing coach from this country, and then you also mentioned a lecturer at the university.
Yes.
Whoa! So, how about the students in the school right now? What's the level of discipline?
You know, the if you talk about education, you are talking of morality, sporting, academic, and all those things well harnessed to bring the best out of the children that you handle. At the moment, I can say with that kind of confidence that we are doing our best. We have interest on kind of moral talks in the school. Every Monday morning, we meet at assembly and reorientate the minds of the students to conform to the doctrine of the mission, the teachings of the mission, so that they can prepare themselves for life in future.
You just talked about discipline.
Yes.
Now, students who are not necessarily Muslims, or for that matter, Ahmadis, how comfortable are they within the premises of the school?
Our basic principle in this school is that there is no compulsion in religion. Everybody is allowed to worship the way he or she wants. And another principle that we use is that nobody should be converted whilst in school here. Of course, after going through the system, having seen the good side of Islam, if you decide to change when you go out, that one is not our problem. But here, we don't intentionally go around to convert.
I've been speaking to a few people who were on this very campus from its very inception. And they tell me that the initial headmasters used to teach. Have you taught before?
Yes. Last year, when they were going to do their exams, I realized that there were some few problems with the students. So I had to go
so
in.
So what do you teach? What subject?
Chemistry is my subject.
Oh, I fear chemistry. Yeah. But can you teach us some chemistry, sir?
No problem.
Okay.
No problem.
I'm just pretending to be part of the students. Okay. probably I'm the tallest student in your class, sir.
Now, because you are all in the first year, and therefore moving, you are in the second year.
Yes.
Okay. I want to test your knowledge about how the atom is like. You know, in everything, the base is very important. And the base of life is what we refer to as atom.
We've had enough here because, you know, I am used to similes and metaphors, but not atoms and smallest indivisible articles and all that. Thank you very much, class. We appreciate your time.
I had the opportunity to go to London through the mission.
Okay.
So I was there when the message came that Uzu wants to see me. I entered the room. He received me very warmly.
And that was your first time of meeting
him? My first time of meeting him in the room for 30, 45 minutes in his office. So he started asking questions about the school, the population at that time, the staffing. Some of the questions that he asked were this.
So did he express interest in the school? You could see passion.
I could see from this man that the love he has for this school is so much.
Wow.
So much that he wants to see this school develop very well. Then he tried to compare other schools and then asked whether my school is doing very well. I told him yes, but there's still more to be done. He looked at me almost after the conversation, and he asked me, Mr. Akonu, can you help in the development of this school? Is it possible you can do it like you have done in other schools? At that moment, I became unsettled. And I didn't know what I said. But immediately what I opened my mind, what came out of it was, yes sir, I will do it. You know, when he was here, he was so affable, so free to talk to. And you will see an aura of spirituality around him. That aura lingers on in the school. No matter what you do, you cannot revolt in this school. We are very hopeful that in the next few years, you will come here and you see a different environment altogether.
Inshallah. So when you interacted with Huzu in his office, out of the numerous schools Ahmadiyya has in the country, he was particular in detail about what happens in Ekrofo TI Ahmadiyya Secondary School. What did that tell you about Huzu and his love and passion for this school?
In Esachel, he stayed here for 4 good years. So he had a lot of interaction with the people in this area. And that informed me about the type of passion he had for this school, for which he had to devote much of his time to ask me questions about this school. You realize that the people in this area seem to have helped him in so many ways. So he developed love for the people, not necessarily the school, because he occasionally asked questions about individuals within this society. Mm-hmm. Is this person there? Is this person there? Yes, then I will answer. So he had that kind of special passion. I don't know, but I saw it in his eyes because the way he was asking the questions. For this particular school, he stayed here for 4 years. Then another issue which is also very important is that he brought the school from the town to this environment. So if the school thrives, it thrives on his prayers. Mm-hmm. So he has that attachment to this school because of the fact that he took the school from the town and virtually brought it here.
Okay.
Nothing available on the land here. Started the process and then wanting to make sure that this school that he started, this school that he built, this school that he sacrificed everything for, this school that his family all had to come here to sacrifice, will not die.
Join us for part 2 next time as we trace Huzu's footsteps back to the north for his last posting in Ghana.
A very unassuming, gentle, and humble human being. That's how I assessed him.
But this used to be one of the living rooms where I used to sit with my friend.
Huzu's wife?
Yes, yes.
Wow. And you were not scared of snakes or anything when you were working here? Because
what do you have to do?
Frankly speaking, I am scared of snakes.
Whenever I would wake up in the night, I would see around, see if there is any scorpion or something, because there were so many scorpions there, snakes or scorpion around you or not. La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah.